Allora, io direi di cominciare. Buongiorno, buongiorno a tutti. Mi presento, sono Luca Mongelli e sono l'Executive Director di MCE, questo centro della Pontificia Università della Santa Croce. In realtà io qui oggi sono in doppia veste perché sono anche Marie Curie Research Fellow dello IESE Business School, con cui condividiamo la partnership sull'organizzazione di questa webinar series, in particolare anche con Humanistic Management, che come diceva Simone, che è questo piccolo blog di amici che condividono una riflessione insieme e con cui siamo entrati in contatto anche con l'International Humanistic Management Association, che ringrazio per averci aiutato a condividere questo spazio. Allora, come diceva Simone, come nasce questa webinar series? Beh, allora, diciamo che io, come diceva Simone, giustamente ho un peccato originale, e il mio peccato originale è il fatto che io non sono un filosofo, non sono un teologo, non sono un sociologo, sono un economista che nasce dentro una business school dura e pura. Comincio i miei studi nell'ambito dell'innovazione, quindi tutta l'attività brevettuale che fanno le imprese per rispondere agli shift tecnologici, no? Come gestiscono le innovazioni per guidare a volte i cambi paradigmatici, no? Nell'ambito di questa riflessione mi sono accorto che il processo innovativo per definizione è l'attività imprenditoriale, cioè un'impresa che entra sul mercato per proporre qualcosa di nuovo per cui qualcuno è disposto a riconoscere un valore. E nell'ambito di questa riflessione ho scoperto un mondo che è quello delle imprese sociali. Imprese sociali che si chiamano così perché fanno impatto sociale. E allora mi sono domandato, ma se le imprese sociali nascono per fare impatto sociale, l'impresa normale a cosa serve? E nell'ambito di questa riflessione, ho incontrato MCE, quindi Don Marty Schlag, professore di teologia morale, Juan Andrés Mercado e professor Robert Gall, che mi hanno un po' aperto al mondo della dimensione etica, okay? Quindi dell'azione, cioè la prospettiva etica dell'azione economica. E sono entrato nel magico mondo dell'umanesimo, no? Dell'umanesimo applicato all'economia e al business. Durante questo percorso di conversione, finalmente ho incontrato Simone, con cui abbiamo cominciato questo dialogo che ci ha portato così a non capirci per un po' e poi a fare delle riflessioni. E questa webinar series nasce proprio così, con l'idea di dire, bah, invece di lasciare la riflessione fra me e te in maniera privata, condividiamola con chi vuole e ne ha piacere. E abbiamo fondato questo piccolo network informale che si chiama Human, e inizialmente pensavamo di fare una riflessione monografica su Erasmo da Rotterdam, dato che Simone è un super esperto di Erasmo. Poi abbiamo deciso di allargare un po' i confini di questa riflessione, mettendo tematiche anche che vanno un po' oltre Erasmo, ma che rientrano nel concetto di umanesimo cristiano e humanistic management. E quindi abbiamo proposto questa webinar series. Ora vi condivido brevemente, Giulia, se mi puoi abilitare la condivisione schermo, così posso condividere il flyer della webinar series. Ok. Eccola qua. Allora, cominciamo oggi. Quello che faremo oggi ve lo lascio per ultimo perché è la parte più succulenta. La prossima volta avremo questa occasione dedicata al tema della solidarietà, sussidiarietà dentro l'organizzazione. Simone farà una riflessione sui principi umanistici che stanno dietro questi elementi, e con Francesco Limone, practitioner molto avvezzo al mondo accademico, proveremo a concretizzarli dentro il contesto dell'organizzazione. Parleremo di sostenibilità come utopia o come utopismo. Qui anche Simone ci darà degli spunti molto interessanti di riflessione con Cristiano Brusco, professore della LUIS. Parleremo di ecologia integrale nell'ambito della riflessione delle Nazioni Unite sull'Agenda 2030 e atterreremo sulla figura del principe cristiano, altro paradigma da cui prendiamo ispirazione per il tema della leadership. Ne parleremo sempre con Simone e con Gigi De Palo. Ed infine condivideremo con voi la riflessione che nasce tra me e Simone in cui cerchiamo di declinare il concetto di auctoritas latina con la figura dell'empowerment, con il concetto di empowerment che l'imprenditore sociale può esercitare, no? Quindi combineremo questi due mondi che sembrano apparentemente molto distanti, che invece abbiamo scoperto essere molto convergenti. E quindi oggi cosa faremo? Beh, oggi iniziamo, prendiamo il toro per le corna, come si dice, nel senso che cominciamo dai principi ispiratori dello humanistic management, e per questo abbiamo il professor Domenech Menet, professor from Jesse Business School. Actually, let me switch in English because Professor Mele is supposed to speak in English because he's more fluent than in Italian, but actually he understands very well in Italian as well. So, but for now, until the end of the presentation, we just shift language. And so, welcome, Professor Domenech Mele. Thank you for being here. I mean, you are the father of humanistic management. I mean, you're not, you say no, but I would say yes, at least in the academic field, since you got so hundreds of citations all over the world with your publication, Journal of Business Ethics, Humanistic Management Journal. So actually, today we want to challenge you with some questions about humanistic management. Now, humanistic management is a concept which is a bit more established than 5, 10 years ago. But my question is, why do we need humanistic management in such a society? Father, the floor is yours.
Well, why we need humanistic management? Well, first of all, maybe you're going to start trying to explain what humanistic management means, no? Because there is not an unanimous answer to this question. Humanism, many people understand the contribution of the Renaissance authors, many Italian authors, by the way, Piccolo della Miranda, for instance, no? But in the modern times, people assume this name from very different philosophical approaches, no? Jean-Paul Sartre talk about humanism, Karl Marx talk about humanism, of course, the Catholic social teaching talk about humanism. What kind of humanism we are talking about? Well, there is certain consensus, however, in that humanism pay attention to the human being, the human person. We talk about management or business management, more specifically. We are talking about the focus on the persons within the organization. Traditionally, the focus is not in the persons as a final end. The focus is rather to the results, to the production, to the performance, if you like. And when people talk about the people, when say people are very important, or immediately he add the people are the best asset of the organization. Or sentence like, if you deal people correctly, the results will be better, no? So basically, the modern management has been dominated by economics. I am not against economics at all. Economics is important to use rightly the means. Economics look efficiency, like engineering look efficiency. I came from my first formation is in engineering. All the time, I remember in my school, engineering school, talk about efficiency, things like this, no? They are focusing the means because the end is taken by granted with these results, productivity, these kinds of things. And following this stream of thought, people are human resources, stricto sensus, no? So are means for the end, which is profitability, efficiency, production, and related concepts. Now, humanistic management change the focus on the person. Even more. Try to change the current paradigm to another paradigm. The current paradigm, you can say, it is an economistic paradigm. So economics, it's the dominant science in business schools. And then the purpose of humanistic management is trying to change the paradigm, to shift from economic paradigm to humanistic management, means a paradigm focused on the human being. That doesn't mean forgot about the results. Of course, the results are very important. You have no results, we have not companies, of course. But people within the organization is not only a great resource, a great mean for the ends. The person are an end in themselves. And then you have to pay attention to how people develop themselves within the organization, how human dignity is respected, how the well-being of people is fostered, etc. They're basically the modern movement of humanistic management. There are different approaches, there are different maybe backgrounds if you want, but everybody agree that respect human being, focus on the human being, respect human dignity, human development and well-being. Yeah? We are a great consensus about this. Eh? And then from then, we have a great task, which is rethinking management from a new perspective.
Father, can I just take the chance to ask you the following question, which actually build on what you are saying. So,
sorry, I can hear well the question. I lost the sound. Could be some technical problem. Could you hear me?
Yes, I think that Luca has some problem with the internet.
Oh, the problem is with Luca. Okay.
I think so.
Can you, Julia, repeat the question, please?
Unfortunately, no. I don't have the questions. I will text Luca.
Well, maybe, I don't know if Luca...
Maybe you can continue with the topic.
No, maybe it would be interesting to talk about the origins of humanistic management.
Great.
Yeah, because humanistic management is not an invention of the 21st century. Yeah? Well, the movement start in the first decade, the first decade of this century. Yeah? But actually, humanistic management, you can find in a number of authors in management thought. For instance, I don't know if you are familiar with the development of the writings on the management, no? On the pioneers. The pioneers, you can find two authors, one who is very well known, which is Frederick Taylor, who present a very mechanistic view of the human work at the organization. Mm-hmm. So managers have to plan very well all the tasks, even to the detail of establishing the times, the movements, everything, no? It is very mechanistic. Eh? So people is like robots. Eh? It's motivated by the economics for the rewards. Eh? Basically, remove what is called by the extrinsic motivation. But other authors, also pioneers, for instance, a lady, I have studied a little bit, it's incredible at this time, at the 20s, it's Mary Parkett Follett. Mm-hmm. Mary Parkett Follett came from the psychology, and she have a more humanistic approach. He said, for instance, don't need to mention a sentence, that the problems in the company are not mechanical problems on one side and human problems on the other side. She said, there are problems. And these problems have different sides, different dimensions. And to be a good manager, you have to pay attention to the problems as a whole, as a whole. You cannot separate the technical aspect on one side and the human side on the other, because both things go together. Well, it is, if you want, a very elemental, but it is a first humanistic approach. Other authors, for instance, another very well known, Elton Mayon, the father of what is called the human relation schools of management. He discovered that people are motivated not only for the external reward, not only for economic incentive, but also for the internal experience in working in good conditions. For instance, the type of peers they have in the work, or the atmosphere, or the type of work they are doing would be very boring, could be more interesting, etc. Well, it is interesting, no? Because he focused on the person. Then the followers of Elton Mayon, they say, well, try to establish correlations between the satisfaction, the other motivations, different of the intrinsic motivation, and the performance. And from here, all the studies focus on this. What kind of conditions produce a better performance? Why? Because the paradigm is the same. The paradigm is taken, I insist, then as granted, and then the human person is only a mean for this end. But little by little, expertise or scholars realize that treating people well, giving people what I call a human quality treatment, is good for results as well. And then even in business schools, it's developed little by little a new discipline, which is called human behavior in the organizations. But again, pay attention to the title. It's not dealing with people. It's trying to discover the human behavior and how manager can control or can manage, if you want, sometimes how can manipulate as well to get better results. Now, I came from the field of business ethics, and I realized that ethics need anthropological support. If you take ethics without anthropological support, only you can present sort of prioristic rationalistic principles. But there are a lot of different rationalistic principles in competition. For instance, philosophers are very much familiar, by sure, of the categorical imperative of Kant and the utilitarian principle of Milton, of Mill, Stuart Mill, John Stuart Mill. But it is a prioristic, which are very different, these principles, because they put aside the anthropology, even the metaphysics, to say the whole truth. No? And then from ethics, I go to the anthropology, the philosophical anthropology. And then from the philosophical anthropology, I discovered the importance to pay attention to the human being, the focus on the human being. And from here came the humanistic management. I wrote an article in 2003. It was the result of a conference in Louvain in 2000, presenting the humanistic management as a challenge we have for the 21st century.
Father, can I just make you a question which is related to this? I mean, could you give this main principle? Principles, I mean, if there are some principles about what does it mean humanistic management. I mean, what are the main principles? I mean, you spoke about the relevance of the person, with the centrality of the person within the organization.
Okay.
There are other complementary elements which characterize humanistic management.
Well, if you want, I can summarize. I wrote a paper in the journal you mentioned at the beginning. Michael Pearson is the editor in chief of the journal, which is Humanistic Management Journal. And I present a number of propositions. Maybe to be very precise, I can read these statements. You can make questions, or maybe I can introduce some small comments. The first point is, humanism seeks a comprehensive knowledge of the human being and therefore is aware of the substantial specificity of all human beings due to the spiritual element, the mind, the soul if you prefer, that distinguishes them from other animals and the uniqueness of each person. It is very characteristic of the person. It's not the labor force. Every single employee is a person. It is very important. Every person is unique, is singular. The second point is the recognition of the whole person without reducing the human being to a few aspects. For instance, in business schools and also in economics, has been for years very popular the model of man called the Homo economicus. It basically is an individual with preferences and instrumental rationality. We try to maximize these preferences, no? Well, human being is obviously much more than this. Human beings have also feelings, have sentiments, have a moral sense, establish relationship with other people. Even these preferences, what kind of preferences? What psychological or cognitive elements forge these kind of preferences? Everything is put aside. Other approaches in management focus on, I don't know, specific psychological characteristics. I think it is an error. Humanistic management have to consider the human person as a whole. Very complex, by the way, but as a whole. It is another point. A third point is humanism respects, protects, and promotes the constitutive dignity of every human being. The innate rights associated with such dignity, that we call the human dignity. So human dignity, in other words, is a central point of humanistic management, this recognition. On the other side, it's part of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It is in the preamble. And so it is not difficult. But sometimes one thing is to say, I recognize the human dignity, but then in business, I try to fulfill the law, which is the minimum dignity. A fourth point is humanism see the human being in permanent development. It calls on him or her to flourish as a human. Well, there's another important point, no? So human being has not only dignity, but also is continuously developing. For good or for bad? No, it is the point of ethics. Ethics try to favor human flourishing. When people have misbehavior, people are rot as a human being. People don't flourish as a human being. Now, we have to pay attention to this. This is the responsibility of each person, of course, but since Since the material, social, and cultural environment can favor it, humanism seeks to foster the conditions Forsage Flourishing, including appropriate well-being. This development. So what does it mean in practice? You have to establish conditions in which people can flourish as a human being. A flourishing being develop virtues, develop the moral character, try to foster whatever is seen can people allow people to put in practice their own talents, their capacities at the service of others. So the senses of the human development is the capacity to discover the others, to serve the other, to love others, to look for the good of the others. And then the organization, that is a great challenge, no? To establish things in this way. The proposition number 5, humanism emphasizes both individual freedom and sociability. And consequently, is in favor of respecting free initiative, dialogue, participation, cooperation, at oneness in social life, respecting diversity. Well, it is a great challenge for the organizations. In practice, many authors agree that this kind of activities is good for performance as well. But it is not the main end of humanistic management. For humanistic management, it is the right thing to do because it is good for the human person. Now, the proposition number 6 is this. Humanism, although it stresses the preeminence of the human beings, also shows a special respect for the identity, worth, at interconnectivity of every living and for the whole of nature. So it encourages people to act with a sense of stewardship, promote harmony between humans and nature, and a sustainable development of humanity. This, you can say, the ecological dimension of the humanistic management. Finally, the proposition number 7 is writing this way. Humanism recognizes that humans are self-transcendent beings, seeking a meaning for their life. It is respectful with religions and spiritual behavior. Well, this is another point which is very much in fashion as well in management, no? The spirituality at the workplace, the discovering of the transcendence, the meaningful work, we need transcendent values for this. Yeah? Well, this could be a number of propositions I present in this paper to open a conversation. And many people have mentioned this article, no? And try to improve these propositions or try to make these propositions practical or things like this.
Father, I just presenting
the second point to your question.
Father, indeed, I just present you on the screen the paper that you were presenting. So, Understanding Humanistic Management, published in 2016 on Humanistic Management Journal. And so actually maybe I can spread the PDF or this article in as a follow-up to this webinar. And thank you for your overview of this huge phenomenon, academic, practical phenomenon, which is inspiring all of us. Now I would like to open the Q&A session. Eugenio, I mean, ask the possibility to make a question since the beginning. So actually I will start from Eugenio, but maybe before Eugenio, also Simone, I don't know if Simone, you wanna start with a question or if you wanna start, tell me Simone, do you wanna start first and then we leave the floor to Eugenio?
Oh, we can start with Eugenio, of course, because he wrote on the chat before me. It's correct.
You are a gentleman, Simone. So, Eugenio, the floor is yours. You can ask the question in Italian or in English as you prefer. Eugenio, non ti sentiamo.
Ora mi senti?
Ora sì, forte e chiaro.
Ho attivato l'audio, ma si era disattivato da questo pulsante. Ok. Allora, okay. Buongiorno a tutti, sarò brevissimo. Allora, sono d'accordo con tutto quello che è stato detto. La mia domanda è questa. Mettendo da parte l'imprenditoria sociale di cui ha parlato prima Luca, nelle aziende invece che hanno l'obiettivo di massimizzare il profitto, quindi la stragrande maggioranza delle aziende, in particolare i dirigenti, qui parliamo appunto di humanist management, che sono valutati in base alle prestazioni, spesso di tipo economico, fatturati, margini, quote di mercato, eccetera, e hanno una parte consistente del loro compenso annuale in base a una parte variabile, che in alcuni casi può anche essere più grande del fisso. Nella vostra esperienza pratica, perché so che avete contatti con varie aziende, eccetera, anche come si può realizzare tutto ciò, specialmente quando un manager rimane 2-3 anni in quell'azienda, poi già sa che se ne andrà e quindi anche la parte umana, magari io l'ho visto tante volte accadere ad amici o aziende di quello fornitore, che si spremono le persone come limoni perché l'obiettivo è massimizzare la parte variabile di quei 2-3 anni e poi arrivederci, grazie.
Well, first of all, I think before to change the practical aspects, no, and to talk about the variable part or the fixed part, these kinds of things, I think it's necessary to change the mind. Humanistic management is, first of all, a question of mindset. Mindset. Discovering why the person are important. Obviously, the social enterprise have a point in favor. The people can realize easily the sense of their work. All the work are serving, even the more mercantilistic company, because you serve the others with products, with service, you create jobs, you create wealth, you serve your own family. But in the social enterprise, well, even the purpose is defined like something with social transcendence. And this can help people to find a new meaning in the work. But you have to pay attention not only to the people who receive the benefits of this company, but also the people who are working in this company. So what kind of meaningful work can discover with this? So humanistic management have to pay attention, of course, the clients, the consumers, they're first of all to the employees. The employees form the community of persons. One of the points of humanistic management, practical point, is the company is not a set of contracts only. Basically, a company is made up by persons who establish links, relations, sometimes even friendship, and the whole company is a community of persons, or if you prefer, a community of work. And it is the first concern of a good manager. This is not disconnected with the sense of the purpose of the company and the products and the clients, because they are also persons. The point is the mindset in which the person is really the center, not only the results. Then you can talk about these technical aspects. It is important as well, no? The humanistic management don't present a number of formulas to apply. No, basically present concepts to create a sort of a mindset. You can also say an ethos, managerial ethos, convictions, deep convictions, deep values, practical attitudes in which the people...
One part of the question of Eugenio was also about the fact that in for-profit companies, because there is this short-term orientation and there is this high turnover, in the sense that maybe managers stay there for a couple of years, 3 years, and then they change, no? So all these kind of interactions, also in terms of friendships, actually cannot find the right humus to take to flourish. So also the way in which people tend to behave are not according to the sense of community, but according to the sense of maximization or the final profit aim or their salaries or exploiting as much as they can the position that they have. I don't know if Eugenio, I got the point of your question. So the question of Eugenio was, how can we speak about the humanistic management in such a context?
Well, the short-termism is the most opposite to humanistic management. If you for a short-term focus, you understand to make profits even at the cost or at the price to sacrifice the future of the company. Yeah? So sometimes you have to sacrifice the short-term profits to pay attention to people, develop people, and then probably in the long term could probably be profitable. Eh? It is a consequence. I insist, the first point of humanistic management is focus on people. Eh? Focus on the result also, but as a means, is exactly to change the order.
Eugenio people is proposing...
Ends, and the profits are means for the ends.
Father, Eugenio is proposing on the chat that maybe we should eliminate stock option and variable part of the salary in order to increase the commitment in the long term of the managers, so that actually they feel the sense of be part of something which is on the long term. Francesco, I know I see that you want to ask a question. Maybe you can do that. You can do that in English. So.
Okay. Yeah, thanks a lot for organizing this and thanks a lot for the interesting discussion. My question is actually very much related to Eugenia's one, because while Eugenia was asking what should we do in terms of managerial, in terms of what kind of management we would ask the company to have, what I would ask is more in terms of the policy we could try to create at the level of society or community, let's say, to imagine that this point of view is actually then taken by the managers. Do we act on education? Do we favor, I don't know, participation of workers into the property of the firm? What kind of policies or laws, if you want, you can imagine to foster this approach?
Well, many things, no? Maybe, so in the company, before policies, you have to establish the, you can say, the constitution of the company, which is the mission statement, the corporate values, and then to teach, make this very clear, and then very important, to be coherent with this, because many companies have a wonderful set of values, like Enron, and then in practice, nothing to do, no, with the values. It is the fair point. They try to apply those values to specific policies. Of course, what you mentioned is perfectly consistent with humanism. If you pay attention to the person is a free individual, no? And then everything who foster initiative, everything who foster participation, everything who foster people can give the best of each one at the service of the community. It is very good. It is very good, no? There are a number of practical concepts you can introduce, like crafting. Are you familiar with this topic? is like translate the whole idea of a craft and the medieval and guides, no, to the big companies, no? So people have feel they are working like something that is my own business, no? Well, but in practice, you have to experience, you have to prove, you have to test. But you have in mind this kind of ideas. I am sure that with creativity, you can discover not only policies, but also specific practices.
Father, I have just a question about this, because actually Eugenio started from criticizing the current, scenario, no, about how corporates are supposed to work. And Francesco says, what can we do in practice to foster this process of humanization of the organization? My question is,
first of all, convince the managers about the importance to change the mind, yeah, no, in it, this.
Where the process start from? I mean, where should we start this process? What is the first action that we had to take in order to
allow this process? I explained before with some minutes ago that the process is a very long process, no? Here start with the human relations school. And then they introduce the importance of participative management. They introduce things like empowering people. They introduce like many things, no? But every kind, all these practices is only specific aspects presented to improve the results. You can take advantage of these practices, but change the orientation. So try to pay attention to the person, and then the result could be fantastic.
Yeah? Sure.
And you can introduce many suggesting. For instance, let me put another example, very important. Perform an appraisal. Perform an appraisal, for me, is one of the main means to introduce humanistic management. What is generally the performance appraisals about? Results, goals. Well, performance appraisal could be also how you deal with people. What kind of human treatment give you the others? What is your concern to prepare your collaborators or the newcomers to the company? What are you leaving the values of the corporation? I don't know, a number of things. Practically, I think all the practices, the current practices of the companies, have to be rethink with this new paradigm. Yeah? It's like, you know, these old buildings, they're very nice stones, yeah? Or even columns sometimes. Yeah? In Italy, we have wonderful monuments, no? But sometimes with this very old and very old castle, people can rebuild this, okay? Or can take some aspects or some elements of this and reveal another thing. There are many things you can take advantage of the current management, but within a new paradigm. So it's not easy. I recognize it is a very hard task, no? But people realize that people are very important. There are many people who are not in the current of humanistic management who present expressions like putting people first. It is a famous title of a book of Jeremy Pfeffer, for instance, the famous professor in California, I think. Putting people first. Okay, fantastic. This could be very good for humanistic management. But why? For what motive? Only to be more productive, or because people is the most important element in the organizations? It is the point.
Thank you, Father. Because actually, speaking about the why, which is behind the human behaviors, should be something that within the organization should be even more discussed. I mean, very often managers are very focused on doing their job, and very often they forgot the reason why they are doing their job. I mean, beyond the salary or beyond incentives or beyond. So actually the idea of discussing the why and the purpose of the organization. So actually this is a new idea which is spending a lot in the academic field about the discussion about the purpose of the organization. What is the purpose of the organization? Simone has a question. Simone.
Professore, mi scusi, la farò in italiano. Però ho capito che lei sa l'italiano meglio di quanto io non sappia l'inglese.
La vera lingua dei tanti.
Infatti, per questo anno, essendo il settecentenario, posso farlo. Poi il prossimo anno yes. prometto di imparare l'inglese. Allora, la domanda è la seguente. Ma da chi suggerisce di cominciare per sviluppare questa nuova cultura di impresa? Suggerisce un percorso che sia top-down, quindi cominciare dalla leadership, o un percorso che sia bottom-up? L'esito desiderato è lo stesso, di fatto è un empowerment organizzativo significativo, però il punto di partenza non è secondario. Gli umanisti nel 1500 si rivolgevano soltanto ai principi, non ai popoli. Tutti quanti i personaggi della cultura 1500esca, anche 1600esca, scrivevano testi alle persone importanti di vario tipo, di vario genere. Andava di moda lo speculum principis, no? Andava di moda il libretto scritto al quello che noi oggi definiremmo al CEO o al, appunto, al sovrano della situazione, invitandolo a un percorso di illuminazione. Però questa percorso non ottenne il risultato sperato e a quel punto nei secoli successivi gli intellettuali iniziano a rivolgersi alla base suggerendo di rivoltarsi contro questi vertici che non erano in grado, non avevano o le capacità o l'intenzione di fare una riforma del genere, perché una riforma integralmente umanistica mette fortemente in discussione il potere del vertice, secondo me almeno, e quindi che il vertice voglia farlo non è scontato. Quindi lei suggerisce più un percorso che è una sorta di evoluzione democratica dell'impresa o più una sorta di leadership illuminata?
Well, personally I think the leadership is crucial. It's not only my personal opinion. Most of the studies about the organizational culture agree the importance of leadership, because in the companies is not a democratic organization. You can discuss it is right or no, but in practice it's not a democratic organization. And then the people in the top establish proceeds, establish values, establish how kind of people you will incorporate into the company. Very important. What kind of people you promote within the organization, how to carry out the performance appraisal, everything came from the leadership. Of course, it is not enough. Culture also has very important role, all the members of the organization. It sometimes takes time. It's not like a very short-term goal, no? To change a humanistic culture. The leadership is very important. That is why I think to introduce this new paradigm, the first thing is to convince the people who are leaders in the companies. It is good. It is good also for the results, probably. But it's necessary, pardon me if I insist too much in this point, no? It's necessary to pay attention to people first of all. Eh?
Thank you, Father.
Leadership. The answer, clearly, is leadership for me.
Thank you, Father. Actually, we have a question from the chat. This is the last question because actually...
Sorry. One thing more. Yeah, so, the people who is in Father. The bottom generally is very happy when he's receive a treatment as a person, you know, as a human resources. Are very happy, no? So, but from the bottom to the top, I think it's very difficult. Eh? It's very difficult. So, at least the companies I know, the Saudi Airlines, for instance, which is a very exemplary company, no, came from the leadership. Came from, but sometimes the leadership is very open. and sometimes listening people or try to learn from examples, from examples. Oh, this is according with humanistic management. Let me introduce this practice. Because it's not, I don't know, a code of things to do. I present a proposition which is very open. It's principles, practically. You have to apply this to the organization. Excuse me, that's all. What else?
No. I mean, you had the floor. You are the main speaker today, so actually we are happy that you put all this emphasis. Because actually this was a question that I also have in mind about the top-down, bottom-up approach. I slightly disagree with you, Father, but actually maybe this is something that we can continue in another setting. I have a question from Miguel. This is the last question I would ask Father to reply as fast as you can, because we are going to end with this webinar. Miguel says, is there a possible way to redirect the organization to focus not as a way to produce goods and beings, but a tool to make improve the society? Because it appears to me that the companies should live and work for people, for the society, and not the way we are doing it. That is, the people live for working for companies. So the question is the company a way to improve the society?
Well, you can distinguish two things here, no? What is the subjective motivation of the entrepreneur? And what is the moral justification of the company? In other words, what gives moral legitimacy to the company? And what gives moral legitimacy to the company is not the enrichment of the shareholders. What gives moral legitimacy is the contribution of the company to the common good of the society, to a good society. And then I absolutely agree that the company have to contribute to improve society. That means improve, starting with improving people who are involved in the company. First of all, the employees. It is another point we can discuss, no? Because the stakeholder approach, probably you know, pay attention to the whole stakeholders. Fine. But I think you have to pay attention to the, first of all, to the people who are more close to the community of people, which is the company. It is the employees and also the people who put the capital to the resources, no, to carry out this. It is like the court of the community. Then, of course, you have to pay attention to the providers, to the clients, so on and so forth. But first of all, the people who are part of the community. So it's a new paradigm who give a new vision. And you have to rethink many things. Many things you can take a lot of advantage of, many things. After more than one century of developing management thought, no? Many things.
Thank you, Father.
Actually, I agree with the question of Miguel.
Thank you, Father. Actually, we were very good in with the closing of the webinar, since it's 2:15. So actually, thank you for your presentation, for answering the questions. Thank you to all of you that joined this webinar. We will see the next webinar, which is in 2 weeks. I would like to end with last comment from Father Martin Schlag, which is make this video in order to address one of the main topic, which is now under discussion in the World Economic Forum, which is a first comment about the Great Reset. The Great Reset, which is the one of the main discussions which is going on now in the World Economic Forum. So I will show with these videos. And with this video, I would say goodbye to all of you. See you in a couple of weeks. please follow us on the socials so that we will keep posted you about the future dates. And thank you to all of you.
Thank you for inviting me. Thank you very much for everybody to for your presence and for your contributions. Thank you.
Thank you, Father.
Carissimi, vi saluto dagli Stati Uniti, concretamente da St. Paul in Minnesota, dalla University of St. Thomas, dove dirigo l'Istituto John Ryan di Dottrina Sociale della Chiesa. Sono sempre molto unito all'Italia con tanto affetto e allora mi rivolgo a voi con alcuni temi che mi premono. E come sicuramente sapete, il presidente del World Economic Forum, del Foro Economico Globale, Klaus Schwab, con un collega Thierry Malheré, ha pubblicato un libro che chiama The Great Reset, il grande reset, il ripristino, no? Grande a causa della pandemia. È abbastanza coraggioso scrivere un libro in mezzo alla pandemia sui cambiamenti provocati dalla pandemia, no? Perché loro stessi affermano nel libro che predire gli eventi futuri è il gioco degli scemi, no? Ma dicono molte cose che solo dopo un anno, quasi un anno della pubblicazione, si stanno verificando già. Allora, loro dicono in questo libro che tutti i campi dell'attività umana saranno permanentemente cambiati dalla pandemia, in particolare nell'economia. Ogni impresa, in ogni tipo di industria, dovrà sperimentare con nuovi modi di business. Chi vorrebbe tornare a quella di prima fallirà. Invece, chi innova, che sperimenta, farà del Covid un'opportunità. E siamo a una crocevia, dicono. Possiamo e dobbiamo scegliere fra o un miglioramento o un peggioramento. Possiamo fare il mondo meno diviso, meno sporco, meno distruttivo o più inclusivo, più equo e giusto che prima della pandemia. E in quel libro anche lodano l'Italia come un paese che ha guidato gli altri nella empatia e nella connessione della società civile. Allora, leggendo questo libro, mi è venuto in mente un altro libro da una nota scrittrice inglese, Dorothy Sayers, che è nota per i romanzi polizieschi, per i gialli che ha pubblicato, ma inoltre a quello era una pensatrice cristiana anglicana e scrisse nel 1942, durante la guerra, scrisse sul lavoro e in particolare sulla vocazione al lavoro dal punto di vista cristiano. E allora lei descrive i sacrifici e le rinunce fatte durante la guerra e dice: abbiamo rinunciato adesso a tante cose e ci siamo resi conto di tante cose sprecate, tante cose superflue. E adesso, dice, durante la guerra siamo costretti, ma poi dopo, quando torna la pace, noi veramente vorremmo cambiare. E perciò pongo la domanda a noi, e di questo continueremo nel prossimo incontro: vogliamo veramente cambiare? Vogliamo cambiare?